bless the name of the Lord for the opportunity to gather together, to worship God, to enjoy His presence, and to fellowship with one another. Praise the Lord. I pray that the blessings that we are enjoying in God will continue to impact our lives in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. We'll go into the word, but quickly, before we do that, just to remind us, do we know what is happening on Wednesday, this Wednesday? Something great is happening in Canada. Cannabis will be legalized. For those who don't know. So, cannabis used to be a hard drug, but the government, they have done their research. They said it's not as bad as they used to think. So now it's being legalized. But, you know, I'm just saying this just to remind us, just be careful on that day. Because nobody knows the impact that it's going to have. You know, in the past, you know, the police had some drugs trained to discover people that were carrying cannabis and all that. You know, of course, those drugs are unemployed now. And even the police don't know yet how to handle that. I'm not trying to throw away fear in your mind, but I'm just saying, just be careful. Because nobody knows the extent it's going to go. So if you see somebody behaving funny, just go on your way. If you are driving and somebody is cutting you off, please just keep your cool and just do everything normally, because we still don't know the extent that this will go. But I pray that the Lord will keep us, He will protect us, no evil will happen in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Amen. And let's also remember to pray for our people in government. Let's continue to pray for them that God will grant them the wisdom and the understanding to take decisions. A lot of the times, just like every human being, they are not perfect. They don't have all the information. They just work with the information that they have. So we need to continue to pray for them, that God will give them godly wisdom, so that what they are doing, you know, will be the right thing. At the end of the day, it may turn out to be a good thing that they are doing, but let's just continue to pray that God will continue to grant them the wisdom, so that all of us can live in peace in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. And also to remind workers, we are going to have our workers meeting after the service. So please, every worker, you are required to wait for that meeting. So today we want to conclude the discussion we started on how to position yourself for God's extraordinary grace. We started this last Sunday, and we said that we will not be able to finish up, but today, by the grace of God, we will be concluding this topic. How to position yourself for God's extraordinary grace. And just by way of reminder, last Sunday, we said that the grace of God has been made available to everyone. I would say the grace of God is what you get without really working for it. And every child of God, every believer, has that grace. Thank you for projecting the last story. So that's the one from last Sunday. Yeah, we said that every child of God enjoys it. We said it's a gift. It's not something you can work for. The moment you start working for it, it's no longer grace. And but we said that, at the same time, even though it is free, even though it is common to everyone, and even though the Bible says that God is not a respecter of person, we realize that in the Bible, it appears some people enjoy more grace than the others. You know, of course, we know that God does what He wants. He distributes His grace the way He wants. But we said that if we can look at the lives of those people, if we can see a commonality, if there's a common thread in their lives, if there's something that is common to them, then if we are able to do those things, maybe we can position ourselves also in a way that we are going to benefit the extraordinary grace that only few people enjoy. Every child of God enjoys the grace of God. For just like we said, there are some people that enjoy the extraordinary one. They seem to enjoy more than the other. So we are saying that, okay, if we position ourselves appropriately, maybe if we pattern our lives, you know, after these people, after the good things that they did, then we too may be able to enjoy God's extraordinary grace. And I pray that the Lord will speak to us today in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. We are going to take our Bible reading from the book of Genesis. Genesis chapter 12. Genesis 12. From verse 1 to 4. I'll read from the NIV version. The Lord has said to Abraham, go from your country, your people, and your father's household to the land I will show you. I will make you into a great nation, and I will bless you. I will make your name great, and you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and whoever curses you, I will curse. And all peoples on earth will be blessed through you. So Abraham went, as the Lord had told him, and Lot went with him. Abraham was 75 years old when he set out from Ar. Praise the Lord. Yes, we saw God calling out Abraham. And, you know, I also want to encourage us. Please, when we come to church, when we learn some things, let us put all these things into practice. Because you don't get blessed just by hearing the word. You get blessed by doing the word. There are so many principles that God has put in his word. That is why we have the Bible. The Bible is a book of principles. It's for us to learn how God deals with people. A lot of these stories that we read, they are not in the Bible just for us to be enjoying the stories. It is because God is treating principles. Every story has a principle. So let us learn those principles. Then we can start seeing, you know, the blessings manifest in our lives. Praise the Lord. So we read the story of Abraham and how God called him out. And of course, we know that Abraham was somebody that enjoyed God's extraordinary grace. Now, God is not a respecter of persons, but respecter of principles. You know, what he has done for one person, he can also do it in the lives of other people. Now, there are so many people that enjoyed, you know, that we can see in the Bible that enjoyed extraordinary grace that we are talking about. But for this morning, we are going to focus on just a few of them. You know, we are going to focus on some people that, looking at it from human perspective, there was no reason why they should be called out like that. There are some people that we may be able to explain it, like Isaac. Isaac enjoyed so much grace from God. But then, God had already blessed Abraham. And Isaac, you know, even before Isaac was born, God has already told Abraham, I'm going to give you a child, you know, which is going to inherit the blessing. So we are going to leave out people like Isaac. But we are going to focus on some people that it's difficult to explain why God called them. One of them was Abraham. Abraham was an idol worshiper, just like other people. Abraham was an idol worshiper. He wasn't a child of God. He wasn't serving God. But God just called him among the other idol worshippers. And God said that, look, I want you to come out of your people. Leave everybody. I want you to separate yourself. You know, so why did God choose Abraham? It's difficult to say, we don't know. It is only when we look at his life after he has been called that we can now say, okay, maybe this, you know, because God has a foreknowledge of everyone. God knows what you are going to do with the grace that you are given. So when we now look at what these people did after they were called, we may be able to say, okay, maybe this is what God must have seen. So one of them was Abraham. And of course, the second one was Jacob. Jacob also was not the firstborn. You know, normally when the blessing of Abraham is transmitted from generation to generation, it is the firstborn that transmits it normally. That's the way it should be. But in the case of Jacob, Jacob wasn't the first one. Of course, it was a set of twins. But Esau was the first one. You know, but even before they were born, God had already declared that this Esau guy, I hate him. I mean, the children were not even born. And God was already saying that I hate Esau. How can you hate somebody that is still in pregnancy? But God had already said so. He said, I love Jacob. So God must have seen something about them. Then the third person that we are going to be looking at is David. David was the last born in the family. David was a non-entity in the society. David was a person that even his father forgot him. His father forgot that he had a child called David. Because when the prophet came to their house, the prophet said, bring all your children. And Jesse, David's father, brought the people that he considered to be the children. But when the prophet had to, you know, minister before God and kept inquiring, you know, from God, who is the person? And it turned out that God did not choose any of them. And the prophet was surprised because the prophet knew that God spoke to him. So the prophet had to ask the man, are you sure these are all your children? And the man had to tell him, oh, there's this rascal in the wilderness. Maybe let somebody go. So he was actually forgotten. And he was the one that God ended up choosing. So we are going to quickly look at some commonalities that we can see in the lives of those people. Now, these people that we are looking at, they were not perfect people. There's no perfect people anywhere. Not in the Bible, not in our world. There's no perfect people anywhere. In fact, in times of their weaknesses, some of them did terrible things. You know, I shared with us last Sunday what David did. What David did was horrible. Some of them did terrible things, but God decided to select them, and that's why favor comes in. And so like I said, when we look at some commonalities in their lives, maybe we may be able to glean some things and come up with possibilities why God called them. And there are so many things that we can see about their lives that are common, but because of time, this morning we are going to talk about just two things out of the many things that were common about these people. We'll just look at two points, and I pray that the Lord will expand the rest in our lives, and hopefully when we have other opportunities, maybe we'll talk more about some of the things that we need. So the first thing I want to talk about is that all these three people, one common thing about them is that they separated themselves to God. At some point, they have to separate themselves from God. Oh, sorry, not from God, from people. You know, they separated themselves from people. You know, a lot of the times, actually, when they were doing it, many of them, they were not even conscious of what they were doing. But that opportunity just came that they separated themselves. For instance, David, he was in the wilderness alone. It was actually in the wilderness that David had an encounter with God. You know, in 1 Samuel chapter 16, from verse 11 to 13, that's when the prophet came to anoint, when Samuel came to anoint David. David was in the wilderness alone. He was the one that was always going to the wilderness to look after the sheep of the father and all that. And it was there that he actually developed his relationship with God. There was a time that Goliath came to come and terrorize them. You know, Goliath now came to terrorize Israel. You know, and nobody was able to fight Goliath. Eventually, David said, I'm going to fight him. Now, what gave him that confidence? Because the king said, even I that am the king, I can't face this guy. Nobody can face him. David said, I was in the wilderness, tending the sheep. There was a time a lion came. I fought the lion. There was a time a bear came, I fought the bear. So it was there that David actually developed all that thing. And a lot of the psalms that we read, David actually wrote them in the wilderness. It was in the wilderness that he was now encountering God. He will look at his sheep, and I was looking after them, and he will say, oh, the Lord is my own shepherd. Just like I don't want this sheep to lack anything, the Lord doesn't allow me to lack. You know, and a lot of those experiences, wilderness that will develop your relationship with God. Not among people. Not when everything is going on well. It is when God separates you. Another example was Abraham. Of course, just like we read, God told Abraham, get out from your people. Leave them. And go to a place that I'm going to show you. So God had to separate him. And God does that all the time. All these people that were used, there's a time that they had to be separated, you know, from other people. What about Jacob? Jacob was a child that was loved by the mother. Everything was nice and all that. But there was a time after he had caused trouble, after he had stolen the brother's birthright, he now left the house. And for the first time, Jacob was alone. It was when he was now in the wilderness, that's in Genesis 28. He was now in the wilderness, he now slept. It was there that God now appeared to him for the first time. God now appeared to him. So, people separated themselves. That's one thing that was common about them. And we see in the Bible that God wants us to be spiritually separate from the world. God expects you to be separated from the world. We are not expected to live according to the sinful traditions of our environment. Don't live like other people. We need to treasure our relationship with God more than what people are going to say. Many of us are so concerned about what people will say about you. In your office, you know, they are celebrating Halloween, they are doing all that, because you don't want them to see you as, you know, you don't want them to say any negative thing about you. You too, you participate with them. Say, after all, I didn't believe it in my mind, I'm just doing it and all that. You know, you have already compromised. You have already compromised. Make your stand known. It will save you from problem. When you make your stand known that I'm a child of God, I don't do all this, in future, they will not bother you. But by the time you are hiding and you are trying to be politically correct, that's when you always get into trouble. God expects us to separate ourselves. In 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 17, I think we can read that, 2 Corinthians 6, 17. Yeah, God says, I said, for we are, verse 17, okay, from verse 16. So what agreement is there between the temple of God and idols? For we are the temple of the living God. As God has said, I will live with them and walk among them, and I will be their God, and they will be my people. Therefore, come out from them and be separate, says the Lord. Touch no unclean thing, and I will receive you. That's what God is saying. Now, God is not saying that we shouldn't live in the world with sinners. There's no way we can not live with sinners. You know, the Bible, I mean, Paul said that. He said, when I said that you shouldn't have anything to do with, I'm not saying that you should leave the world. However, what God is telling us is that there are sinful practices. Any tradition that does not glorify the name of the Lord. The Bible said that we should have nothing to do with it, with the unfruitful works of darkness. So anything that doesn't glorify the name of the Lord, we are not expected to partake of it. So that is what it means to come out. James chapter 4 verse 4 says that friendship with the world is enmity with God. If you are trying to please you, of course there will be some things that are not harmful that the world is doing, but there will be some things that are, you know, that are really harmful. There are some things that you just have to make your stand known. You know that, no, I'm not going to be a part of this. And Philippians chapter 2 verse 15, he said that we are living in the midst of a wicked and perverse generation. God has already told you. So don't tell God that, hey, God, it's because this place is so tough. That's why I can't live a righteous life. No. God has already told you up front. He said you are living in the midst of wicked and perverse generation. He said, but among them, you should shine as stars in the sky. So live, you are in the same wicked world, but God expects you to shine like stars. So God wants us to be separate. He wants us to separate ourselves. We need to separate ourselves from the world and do things that family is the deep respect and honor that they have for God. They honor God deeply. They respect God. And I believe that this particular reason, even though, of course, David was also a worshiper, but everything ties together, this particular point is the reason why David was able to get away with so many things. David respects and honored God deeply. There was a time he was going to make a sacrifice, and somebody presented a parcel of land that the sacrifice you are making is for everybody. So you just take the land. David said, no, I will never offer to my God what costs me nothing. David loved God so much. So he was able to get away with so many things. Now, all these three people that we are looking at, they moved away from the level of obedience to delighting God. You know, as a child of God or as children of God, God expects us to obey Him. Now, obedience is one thing. Delighting in God is a higher level of obedience. Obedience is you are doing what you are asked to do, which is good. But when you delight in God, even what God has not asked you to do, you just think in your mind, if I do this, this thing will make God happy. Then you do it. That is delighting in God. And that is one thing that we see about these guys. They not only obeyed God, but they delighted in God. Obedience to God is mandatory. All of us, we are required to obey God. But to delight in God is a voluntary thing. You will not see any scripture that tells you how to delight in God. That one is from your heart. It comes out of the love that you have for God. Nobody will tell you. But at the right time, when the opportunity comes, when the opportunity to delight in God comes, it's you that will decide whether you want to do it. And that is one area that God blesses specially. Some of the greatest blessings that God has ever pronounced on people, God pronounced them because they delighted in Him. Not just because they obeyed Him. Of course, there are blessings that God pronounced because people obeyed Him. For instance, in Genesis chapter 22, God called Abraham to sacrifice Isaac. And of course, Abraham obeyed. He was ready to kill the one, God stopped him. And because of that, God was so impressed that, look, at age 100, I'm just giving you a child. And I'm asking you to kill that boy for me. And because you fear me so much, you obeyed me because of this thing that you have done. Then God now began to make some pronouncements. So as a result of obedience, God pronounced that. But in so many other cases, we see people out of their own initiative, out of the love they had for God, they began to do things. And God was so impressed. One example that I love so much is 2 Samuel chapter 7. When David decided to build God a house. 2 Samuel chapter 7. You know, God has given David so much victory and all that. And David was in his palace one day. And he called Prophet Nathan. He said, look, something is not right here. The Almighty God that gave me victory, the ark of the Lord is living in a tent. I am living in this beautiful building. What about God that gave me the victory? He said, no, I have to build a house for God. Now, it has never happened before. God never asked anybody to build him a house. Nobody has ever built God a house. But then he just said, how can I be living in a house? And the Almighty God that gave the victory is living in a tent. Something is wrong. We have to change it. I have to build God a house. And God was so impressed. And God told Nathan that, look, ever since I brought you guys out of Egypt, I've never asked anybody to build me a house. Nobody has ever done it. He said, how come? I mean, how did it get into this boy's mind to build me a house? And God told him that, you are a terrible guy. You are a man of blood. You will not build that house. He said, but because that mind. He said, there are some things I'm going to do. Then God began to give him some blessing. He said, even if your children, even if they sin against me, normally I will have deposed anybody that sinned, just like Saul. When Saul sinned against God, God kicked him out. He kicked the family out. But God told David that, because you just thought of building me a house, he said, even if your children sin against me, I'm not going to cast them away. I can remove them, but I will make sure that there will be somebody from your lineage that will sit on my throne. And of course, we know that the Lord Jesus Christ came through the lineage of David. Now, that was a blessing that came because somebody delighted in God. God never asked for it, but he just made up his mind that he was going to do it. So there's a lot of blessings. You know, of course, there's another example in the case of Solomon. In 1 Kings chapter 3, you know, Solomon made sacrifices to God. Nobody told him. It had never happened before, but the Bible said that he offered 1,000 sheep just because he loved God. Not that he was expecting anything. He just loved God and he just did it. And the Bible said that God appeared to him that night. And God said, ask me something that I'm going to do. God was expecting him to ask for money or maybe to have victory over his enemy and all that. And this guy asked for wisdom. God said, okay, I'm going to give you the wisdom you're asking for. And you are going to be the wisest king ever. Like, even the one you did not ask for, I will still give you anyway. I will still give you. You are going to be so rich that you are going to be richer than other people. You know? So how did the blessing come? Because he delighted in God. Let us learn to delight in God. Let us learn to delight in God. Let us learn to honor God with our money. Money is a very difficult thing to give. Many believers have still not broken out of that mold. Let us learn to honor God with our money. People can honor God with their time, they can do things, they can do all, and all of them are good. But the moment it comes to money, people find it so difficult to give to God. Let us honor God with our money. God gave us everything that we have. Let's give God our tithes, our first fruits, our offerings. All these things are in the Bible. But you know, there are things that you do to delight in God. And when you are giving to God, don't give him because you are expecting something back. All these people that we talk about, that God bless, they didn't give because they were expecting something. They gave because they love God. Today, when people give, they are giving because they want God to give something back to them. No, that's not love. When you love somebody, you give something, you don't even expect anything in return. Of course, we know that our God is a blesser. Our God has more than you can ever need. We see examples in the Bible. In Genesis chapter 14, from verse 17 to 23, Abraham was coming from a war. You know, God had just given him victory. And he met Melchizedek. And Melchizedek praised him that, wow, God bless Abraham, that God has given you victory over all your enemies and all that. And the Bible said that Abraham gave him a tithe because Melchizedek was a priest. So Abraham tithed. And of course, also in Genesis 28, from verse 16 to 22, you know, the Bible talks about Jacob. Jacob was sleeping in a place, and God appeared to him. And God said, I'm the God of your father, Abraham, Isaac, and all. I'm going to bless you. This land where you are, I'm going to give it to you. And the man woke up and said, wow, if God is going to indeed protect me, provide food for me, bless me, then I'm going to give him tithe of everything I want. You know, it's always funny to me when people are giving so much about his tithe, and they say it's an Old Testament thing, it's a New Testament, and people just argue and argue, and I just laugh. For me, God has not given me the release to teach on time. Otherwise, I would have spent time to teach on it. But, you know, we have to minister out of body. God has not given me the body yet. You know, but when we are talking about this, you see, tithing has nothing to do with Old or New Testament. It's just your love for God. You know, Jacob said, if God is going to indeed bless me and provide for me, then I'll give him tithe. I mean, it's actually part of worship. Tithing is part of worship. What you are just saying when you give your tithe is that, look, everything I have is from God. I respect that it is God that gave it to me. That's why I'm giving this 10%. So it's not really a big deal. It's not really a big deal. That's why Abraham, nobody told Abraham to give tithes. But he just felt that. And it was that same tradition that, you know, that flowed down the line. Abraham did it. Isaac must have done it. Otherwise, that idea wouldn't have been in Jacob's mind. Maybe Jacob has been seeing his father doing it, but he wasn't doing it. But there was a day God now appeared to him and I said, wow, then I'm going to start tithing now. So it's part of your worship. It's part of your worship. Also, Proverbs chapter 3, verse 9 talks about first fruits. And he said that honor God with your first fruits. It's an honor. It's not a business transaction. It's just an honor. It's a way of honoring God. You know, where I came from, even, you know, by tradition, nobody knows about the Bible and all that. You know, when your parents sponsor you to school, and eventually you graduated, you know, the tradition where I came from, not the Bible now, the tradition is that your first salary belongs to your parents. Or if it's an uncle that sent you to school, your first salary belongs to that uncle. Now, that is the first fruit. That is not the Bible. But it's just common sense that, look, when somebody has helped me, I should just appreciate them. Now, God has now put it in the Bible. Why is it so difficult to do? Why is it difficult? Praise the Lord. So let us learn to honor God with everything that we have. Now, the best proof of what you value is your bank statement. You can say so many things. Oh, I come to church. I sing. I do all that. Oh, I give my time. It's your bank statement that shows what you believe in. If you have a list in your bank, you pay mortgage, you pay, you know, you can't buy gifts for your spouse, you can't buy gifts for this one, and everything is just there, and you're like, I love you, I can die for you. It's not true. It is not true. You don't love them. You can just, it is your bank statement that shows what you value. If I want to know what you value, all I need to have is your bank statement. How do you spend your money? Your money is the most important thing to give. Even as I was preaching here, the moment I began to talk about money, some people began to look down. They were looking at my face before. But the moment money came, they began to look down. That's a dangerous area. Drive slowly. Let us learn to honor God. Let us learn to honor God. You know, God, we actually break God's heart when we say some things. Particularly when people argue about giving money and all that, you know, it's really painful to God. You can imagine your children, as when you heard two of your children discussing, and they now say that when daddy grows up, if I don't take care of him, will he disown me? And the other child said, no, he's going to disown me. Then maybe I don't need to take care of him. How do you feel? You feel very bad. So the only reason why this child will take care of you is because he doesn't want you to disown him. So that means the love is not really there. If the love is there, whether disown, in fact, the issue of disowning does not even come in. If the love is there, you will do it from your heart. So whether it's in the Bible or not, I mean, assuming it's not even in the Bible, you mean you wouldn't give anything to God? Assuming it's not in the Bible, you wouldn't give to God. God that gave you life. You know what heaven is? Many of us, one of these, we'll talk about heaven. If you know what God has done for you, there is nothing that is too big to give to Him. So let us learn to love God. Let us learn to honor Him with our money. It's no big deal. Another way to honor God is to respect anything that has God's name. Whenever anything has the name of God, let us learn to respect it. I believe one of the key reasons why God decided to love Jacob. You know what I mean? Jacob and Esau, they were twin brothers. But before they were born, God said, I love Jacob, I hate Esau. You see, the issue of Jacob stealing his brother's blessing and all that, he just got himself into trouble. Without doing it, the blessing will have come to him anyway. Because God has already chosen him, that he's the one I want. So, by using human wisdom to steal his brother's blessing, he just got himself into trouble. And he suffered all through life because of that. I believe one of the reasons why God loved Jacob was because Jacob understood sacred things. When you say something is sacred, he understood it. The blessing of Abraham is a sacred blessing. That blessing was passed down from, you know, God has made some pronouncements. That pronouncement was transferred down to Isaac. Now, that blessing was about to be transferred to Esau. And this guy asked, Esau went to Jacob, give me some food. And the guy said, send me your birthright. And the word to use is the birthright when I'm hungry. Take the birthright. What if you read that comment in the Bible, you know, in Genesis 25, I think it's in verse 34, there's a note there. It said, and Esau despised his birthright. He despised it. That was very painful to God. That does this guy know what he's talking about? Because what Esau despised is the blessing of Abraham. When you have the blessing of Abraham, you can never lose. Nobody can ever fight you. Look, five kings were fighting Abraham. Five countries. Abraham fought them only with 308 domestic servants. And he won them. He won five nations. With just domestic servants. When you have the blessing of Abraham, nobody can even stand against you. And these are the things that Esau did not understand. And then you can have it. The Bible says he despised his birthright. So let us learn to respect sacred things. When anything has the name of God, let's give him respect. Don't just throw the name of God anyhow. When they say this place is the house of God, treat it with respect. It may look like an ordinary building, but because it is named after God, let us treat it with some respect. Don't just mess up the whole place and just say, no, it doesn't really matter. It matters. How do you think God would feel? Anything that is tied with God, respect it. When you say somebody is a man of God, respect them. Respect them. It's good. Anything that has God's name attached to it. And be careful in your exclamation. Oh, God is not a good exclamation. Because that is the way people use it now. When they say, oh God, why are you just calling God? That is so rude. It's so rude. You hit your head, you hit your leg, it's like, oh Jesus. So it's just an exclamation mark. People have turned God's name to an exclamation mark. And God made it clear in the Bible. He said, don't call my name in vain. He said that anybody that calls my name in vain is going to account for it. Stop calling God's name in vain. Things are, oh Jesus, just like, of course, unbelievers, we do it all the time. But as Christians, we are not supposed to be doing that. We need to respect God's name. Jesus shouldn't be something like, oh Jesus, oh God, oh that. That is not how to use the name of God. Let us respect God. Let's give him that respect. Let's honor him. Don't just be throwing his name around as if it's one thing that is not important. You know, let us learn to respect God. You cannot keep getting miracles and special blessings from God if you do not honor him. Malachi chapter 1, verse 6 to 8. We'll just quickly read that. I know our time is far gone, but I just want to read that because it brings out something very important. Malachi chapter 1. From verse 6, they say, a son honors his father and a slave his master. If I'm a father, where is the honor due to me? If I'm your master, where is the respect due to me? Says the Lord Almighty. It is you, priests, who show contempt for my name. But once, have you shown contempt? By offering defiled food on my altar. But you ask, how have we defiled you? By saying that the Lord's table is contemptible. When you offer blind animal for sacrifice, is that not wrong? When you sacrifice lame or diseased animal, is that not wrong? Try offering them to your governor. Will he be pleased with you? Will he accept you? Says the Lord Almighty. So what God is saying, that even though I'm greater than your governor and all that, but why don't you give me the same respect that you give them? Why don't you respect me like Justin Trudeau? Why don't you respect me like that? If Trudeau is coming to this place by 10 a.m., Of course, we know that even before then, the door will be closed. So why don't we give God that same level of respect? Even though it's greater than him. But why don't we respect God? So that is what God is saying. Now, if you want to enjoy God's special favor, you cannot treat him as dog and expect him to specially favor you. The Bible said, I draw near to me, I'll draw near to you. That means you are the one that initiates how God is going to relate with you. If you get completely sold out to God, you start treating God as someone who is very important, then you start seeing some things happening in your life. The favor that other people are not enjoying, you start enjoying it. The moment they say this thing has to do with God, and you just treat it as if it's something that nobody else must touch. The moment you start treating God that way, you start seeing extraordinary favor manifesting in your life. But if you don't want to treat God specially, then don't expect him to treat you specially. But I pray that the Lord will help us, that we are going to give God the honor due to him in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Of course, the starting point to honor God is to accept his offer to become his child. You know, when God said that, look, I am a very great God, but I'm giving you an offer. I want you to become my child. So the number one way you can honor him is by accepting that invitation. But if God said that I want to invite you to my family, and you say, no, I don't even care about belonging to your family, then you are not honoring him. And the Bible says that, you know, as many as receive Christ, those are the ones that God has given the power to become the Son of God. So to become a child of God, all you need to do is just receive Jesus as your Lord and Savior.